your attention, please. I'd like to welcome you to the second lectures of the series this year of 2000, and we're very fortunate to have Marius Peladeau with us tonight. Last year we had him here for the first time in over 20 years, and he was very active in the early days of the society, helping us get started as executive director of the Maine League of Historic Societies and Museums way back in ancient history. Tonight he's going to talk about Chansonetta Stanley Emmons, who was one of the great photographers of Maine, and I'll let him go from there. So without further ado, Marius Peladeau. Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Well.
To the people in the back, I don't know if you'll be able to see the slides better when we get to that point. Move ahead up if you want. I got dressed up in the car and started coming up Route 2 this afternoon. When I got to Rumford, I said, oh my gosh, I'm afraid I'm going to be underdressed. I bet you Stan is going to have a dress shirt and a tie on. And he didn't tell me that the dress code for Bethel Historical Society speakers is the same as the old Bethel Inn dining room code. So, being underdressed. But anyway, it's good to be back in Bethel. I'm going to speak to you tonight about Chansonetta and show you some of her photographs on the slides, and then look at these afterwards. She's a fascinating lady. Bernice Abbott, who did the introduction for our book back in 77 on Chansonetta, didn't get mad at me, but she sort of dug in her heels a little bit, because she was a great photographer herself. And she said, do not call her a woman photographer. Bernice tells you I'm a woman. Chansonetta tells you she's a woman. You don't have to say woman photographer. You don't say woman carpenter. You don't say woman plumber. You don't say sculptress. A sculptor is the word. Of course, you all know Actors' Equity, the union for actors, is actors. I was general manager of the theater at Monmouth for a summer, and all the ladies are actors. Actress is merely a Hollywood term. So the word photographer is the word, and photographer doesn't have to be compromised by adding the word woman to it. There it goes, Dan. She was born in Kingfield in 1858. The families were an old New England family from the Massachusetts Bay Colony who had come to Kingfield or to Maine looking for cheaper and virgin land where they could ply their vocation as farmers if they rolled away enough rocks. Her father was, I would say, a middling prosperous farmer. Her older brother, Isaac, was born at such a period in that he was old enough to go into the Civil War and came back with many stories, of course. Her second brother, the second oldest, was Bayard, who, whilst Isaac came back and became a very prosperous farmer, and Bayard also became a very prosperous farmer. The third born were the twins, Francis Edgar and Freeland Oscar, always in that order because that's the way they came out of the womb. And then Chansonetta. Now, people ask, where does Chansonetta, the name, come from? It's not a good Yankee girl's name. Well, if you remember your high school or college French, you know that if you add any TTE to the end of any French noun, it becomes a diminutive of that noun. In other words, minou for cat, minette is little cat or kitten, chanson is song, chansonette is little song. And my theory, it's only my theory, nobody else has come up with another one, is that after having all those boys, Mrs. Stanley finally named her little girl My Little Song. For us, maybe she cried a lot and it sounded like a song. I don't know. But anyway, it was too much of a mouthful for Maine Yankees to pronounce, and so for all of her life she was called Netta. And she didn't like that particularly, but she never complained, but she never used it herself. She was very proud of her very distinctive name. She realized it set her apart from all the Rachels and Agnes and Marys and Jones and so forth. And so she signed her name in full, Chansonetta Stanley, and then finally Stanley Emmons. She went to the one-room schoolhouses of Kingfield, and at the age of 18, like all the other girls, had to decide what to do. 99.9% of them had got married and had children and husbands and households, and a few adventuresome ones remained maidens and had a career, and there weren't that many careers for women. And so she decided on one of the more popular ones, which was teaching. She enrolled in the Western Maine Normal School, which we now know as the University of Maine at Farmington. intending to become a teacher, but at some point some faculty member said, "Oh, Miss Stanley, you have such a wonderful manual dexterity, you paint and draw so well." And so she announced to herself in the world that she was going to become a great painter. And she went off to Agumpa first to study with Charles Woodbury, and then she went off to Boston. In the meantime, Effie and F.O. had gone to Bowdoin and graduated, the first in their family to do so from college, and had set themselves up as photographers in Lewiston. And Effie was the inventive mind with the gears always working in his head. And F.O. was the more stolid businessman, count the money and keep the ledgers tight. And they made a good pair. But Effie was very upset with the state of photography at the time because the dry plate negative was not what he wanted it to be. And so he came up with a formula which was better, and he came up with a mechanical means of putting the emulsion on the glass plate, which was a great improvement. And so they started making the Stanley dry plate in a little building which is now the Lewiston Sun Journal on Park Street in Lewiston. It took off like mad. It rose to number one in the market, and the Eastman Kodak dry plate plummeted to number three. And of course, this seriously dented the ego of a very egotistical man by the name of George Eastman up there in Rochester, New York. And so he figured he wasn't going to be outdone by any rubes from Maine, and he came and offered the twins a lot of money to buy them out. And they sort of laughed in his face and said, "Sorry, Georgie, but we're having a lot of fun with this business." And so they said, "Go on." And over the years, Eastman would continue to offer them increasingly large sums of money, and we'll get back to that. But anyway, through F.E., Chansonetta learned something about the rudiments of photography and stopped in the studio long enough to have her picture taken. And I'm hard at guessing the ages of women. I mean, I look out over this room and I'm sure there's not a woman here over 29. I mean, I'm just very bad at it. So I don't really know quite how old she is, but I would guess between 18 and 20. A very pretty lady, as you can see. But she wasn't deterred by this photography bit. She wanted to be a great painter. So she, as I said, went to Boston and studied and studied and studied. And finally, some teacher, God save his gumption, said, "Miss Stanley, you are very good in attendance. You are very good in practicing. You are very good in listening. You are very good in, but you just don't have it to be a great artist." Well, she could put her tail between her legs and come back home and cry on mommy's shoulder. But she was not of that type to admit defeat. So here she is in Boston in her late 20s with no career prospects. And I'm sure it dawned on her that she was getting to be on the verge of venerable spinsterhood, and something had to be done. And so she looked around, or someone saw her, and sure enough, she found she was tall. She was quite tall for her generation. She found a tall, good-looking man by the name of James Nathaniel Whitman Emmons. And as you can gather with all those names, he was a good Boston Brahmin of all the right lineage. And they made a good pair physically. He was tall and handsome, and she was tall and pretty. They both wore clothes very well. He had all the social graces. And from everything that I can hear from people who knew them, it was a love match. Things went along well. The little baby was born, and they named her Dorothy. The only problem is that James was the living embodiment of the old axiom that all genealogists know, is that no matter how blue the blood, sooner or later it will run thin. For all his carriage, James didn't have it all up there, and he was a lousy businessman. I'm sure he was a loving wife, husband. I'm sure he was a good father. I'm sure he was a very fine man. Everybody said he was a fine man. He just could not run a business. And I have tracked the shoe store, that was his business, in the Boston City Directory over the years. And every year it moves to a different location. One year he's in downtown Boston on Tremont Street. The next year he's out in Roxbury. The next year he's down on Washington Street. Then he's up in Dorchester. The next year he's in the South End. And then he's up, you know, you can see what's happening. He's one step ahead of the creditor, or one step ahead of the rent collector, or one step ahead of bankruptcy. And I don't know how many of you know Boston, but at one point the shoe store was on Washington Street at the crossing across from Jordan Marsh and Filene's. Now, if you can't make a shoe store run at that location, you can't make it run anywhere. So the next thing we see is a bunch of photographs and a little album about this big, and all the light writing underneath is in Chansonetta's hand. And the first picture is our house in Dorchester. And you look at that house, three stories high with turrets and balconies and bay windows and wraparound porches, and you wonder, how are they doing this? Well, back to F.E. and F.O. F.E. has solved the photography business. He's bored. He wants another challenge. So he tells F.O., I think I can make an automobile run on steam power. So the next time George Eastman comes knocking on our door, let's take his last offer. And George does come. He makes an offer so obscene that they say yes, and then George realizes he doesn't have the money that he's offered. He's got to go running around trying to get financial support for himself. But they finally, the brothers are ready to sell. So they sell, and the only condition is that Eastman, as long as he manufactures the dry plate, and I wish I had brought a box of them, is that it must say the Stanley dry plate with the Stanley family crest. And if you want to put in small letters, manufactured by Eastman Kodak, Rochester, New York, you can do that. But you must call it, as long as you use FE's emulsion and FE's process, you must call it the Stanley dry plate. Well, of course, Eastman had no problems with this because he was buying the name. He knew it was the marketing genius and the quality that he was buying. And so the Eastman plate became the sort of, shall we say, you and I, everyday photography hobby plate, and the Stanley plate remained to the very end of the dry plate business the premium plate for professional photographers. Well, so anyway, the brothers had made their millions on the dry plate business, and now they had millions on top of millions from the sale to George Eastman, and so they moved to Newton and set up the Stanley Steamer Automobile Company. So they're not far from Dorothy, Chansonetta, and James in Dorchester, and Dorchester at that time was a good address. So we can see that F.E. and F.O. are doing the Yankee thing. They're helping out Sis. They were notoriously tight with the money, but we know that Yankees don't get rich by giving it away. You squeeze it. So they were more than willing to help out Chansonetta, but they didn't lavish it all over the countryside. So things going along swimmingly until, unfortunately, Jane does something dumb. He catches blood poisoning and dies. And so Chansonetta in her early 40s is a widow with a young child support. And this is in the fall. And the brothers say, well, don't worry about the cow, don't worry about the horse, don't worry about the house. Take the dog and go up to Kingfield and just sit with mother for a while and spend the winter up there. Don't do anything rash. We'll take care of all the things down in Dorchester. So she does. She packs her woolen underwear, her woolen gloves, her woolen earmuffs. And out of some serendipity, she packs this camera, which she has borrowed from F.E., to take those house pictures. Now the house pictures are good. It's our house, it's James reading the paper, it's my favorite roses, Dorothy's dolls, Dorothy playing with Casey next door, our pet cow, our pet horse. You know, they're typical snapshot pictures. But if you look at them, if you can get away from the subject matter, which is mundane, they are beautifully composed, beautifully lit, and beautifully printed. So the talent is there, she just doesn't need it yet, until after James dies, of course. Then she needs a vocation. So she goes to Kingfield and sits with mommy for a while and vegetates. But then, of course, everybody in Kingfield is either an aunt, an uncle, a nephew, a cousin, or they've known her all her lives. So she starts getting invitations to tea, and she starts going out, and she starts to take her camera with her. And she'll say, Aunt Hannah, could you move your chair a little closer to the window? Yes, that's right, do your embroidery or knitting. Let me take your picture. And of course, everybody is very sympathetic to the young widow, humor her. Well, she's not young, but anyway, middle-aged widow. Humor her, let her take your picture. And so she takes a series of pictures. She has them developed, or she develops them, and prints them, and they turn out pretty well. And everybody says, oh, why don't you hang out in the church hall? And she does, and everybody oohs and ahs. And this gives her confidence to go back to Newton in the spring, Dorchester. And we're not quite sure how this happened. Did she just go back and say to F.E. and F.O., I've decided to become a professional photographer, bang, explosion, and they said, huh? Or had she prepared the way? Because they had sold the house in Dorchester and had rented for her a half of a nice little duplex at 21 Bennington Street, and still stands. It's a nice little brick Tudor style duplex. So they knew she was coming back, so that what happened was not exactly clear to me. But anyway, there she is. She's announced she's going to become a professional photographer. Now, she is for the rest of her life. Now, if you go by the dictionary definition, a professional is one who makes his living or her living off that particular skill, as opposed to an amateur who who may have the same skill. I'm not saying amateurs are any less than professionals. It's merely that they're not making their living off of that skill. In other words, you may make very beautiful tables, but in reality, you're getting your income from your stock brokerage or something or other. Okay? You look like a stock
broker. I'm reading my mail.
All right. Yes, she wasn't a professional in that she sold her photographs. But if she had been thoroughly honest with herself, there was a dichotomy there. Yes, she could say, I sell my photographs, and from the income, I put food on the table, I clothe Dorothy and myself, we have gas to go to Cape Cod or Nantucket or the Berkshires to take pictures, we go back to Kingfield every summer, we can put up in Gumpit overnight, et cetera, and buy my developing fluids and chemicals and so forth. But if she was truly honest with herself, the other half of her brain would have said, yes, Chansonetta, but admit that Effie and Effo are paying the rent every month. Every 2 or 3 years, they're buying you a car, which is a major expense. They're paying for your trip to Europe and the Carolinas. And they're putting Dorothy through Wellesley, which wasn't cheap even then. So, yes, she was getting income, but she was never self-supporting. And the reason for that is twofold. First of all, she was too generous. If Randy had come up to her and said, oh, Mrs. Emmons, that's the most beautiful sunset or sunrise, I don't know, Randy, or Mount Zircon. I just love that picture. She would say, oh, Mr. Bennett, you can have it. And she would just hand it to him, you know, like that. So she gave away too many pictures. And the second is that even though she sold her pictures, the men photographers of the period could not believe that a woman was in the profession professionally, that they must be amateurs or hobbyists or dilettantes. You just couldn't believe that you'd make your living as a woman off of this profession. So she could never charge as much as a man would for work of comparable quality. But she became quite well known, very well known. Her pictures of the Carolina were exhibited at the South Carolina Art Institute. She joined the Society of Arts and Crafts in Boston, which is still there on Newbury Street, where you can buy fine arts and crafts. She joined the photography club of the society. She had work shown at the Museum of Fine Art. She had work in photography magazines. She won juried exhibitions and so forth. Well, anyway, she did very well in a way. She very quickly hit upon her vision. Now, she goes back to 1858 and by relation with her brother, the Civil War. And of course, maybe even her father and grandfather have told her tales of settler days in Kingfield to go back even to the 1800s. So here she is straddling the 20th century and seeing Maine especially, but all of New England, changing rapidly. Of course, her brothers and Henry Ford are the two great agents of change, the automobile. It gives everybody mobility they never had before. And of course, you have Edison and his light bulb. You have the Washburn brothers from Livermore who go out to Minneapolis and found gold metal flour. And it's now cheaper to get a barrel, big wooden barrel of flour from Minneapolis, gold metal flour, than it is to take it down to the local grist mill in Kingfield. You now, all the wives are saying to their husbands, break up that old spinning wheel or loom or make it into kindling or put it up in the attic. I can now get bolts of cloth from Sears Roebuck. Why, I can even get a whole cotton print dress from Montgomery Ward's every season. I don't need that old stuff. So she sees what's going on. And there is this nostalgia, if I can use that word, or romanticism of the past that she admires, the great Yankee individuality and strengths of pioneer families. And we're into the neoclassical period, and you know what that all means. So she makes a very conscious effort here in the opening decades of the 20th century to preserve the 19th century she had known. Now, we had roughly 1,200 to 1,500 prints and hundreds of glass plate negatives when we started this project, and it dawned on me one day, the 20th century, does it ever show up in these pictures taken in 1920? And I went through them, and I found one picture with a light bulb hanging from the ceiling. And I found two pictures of the same road. One side shows the power lines going down the road, and the other side shows a mechanical baler and a steam tractor getting in the hay. And those are the only three pictures I could find out of thousands in which the 20th century intrudes itself. If she took a picture of a kitchen and there was a light bulb hanging in the ceiling, she would lower her camera and crop it out and tell them to put a kerosene lamp on the table. So these are very carefully posed pictures. I won't get into that, but maybe I will with the slides. Well, anyway, she makes some money by painting miniatures on ivory or porcelain, you know, the little pendants or the little brooches that women wear, the little blue-eyed, blonde-haired, little bundle of joy. Well, she made a very good little auxiliary income from painting these miniatures. And if you've ever seen a miniaturist work, they work under huge magnifying glass because the work is so fine. And some of the brushes are no more than one hair. And I'm not going to pull one out because I don't have that many left. But just picture a paint brush, a painter's brush, with just one hair on the end of it to paint with. It's extremely fine work. And this stood her in good stead later on. She also started the idea of slideshows. And she would use the magic lantern and glass lantern slides, which I'll get into. She and Dorothy was grown up obviously by now, not at Wellesley. They would go to any group that would offer them an honorarium and or a free meal. And Chansonetta would be up here talking about her slides with the Carolinas or Europe or New England. And Dorothy would be back there putting the slides in the projector. Well, Chansonetta, as she got older, got deaf and finally went totally deaf, hard of hearing and then totally deaf. And so they switched places and Dorothy got up here. And of course, Mother and Dorothy had given this narration so many times that they had memorized it. And it was never written down, so we don't know what it was, but I don't think that's a big loss, as you will see. At least I hope you agree it won't be a big loss. So they put her along. She straddles an interesting period. Of course, photography has always had, from the very beginning, the mission of historically documenting something, a street parade, a gentleman or a lady, starting with Daguerre's first daguerreotype. It's a view out of his window at a cityscape. We have early daguerreotypes of Andrew Jackson, Henry Clay, Daniel Webster. This is part of preserving history. Matthew Brady, the Civil War battlefields. But by the end of the century, we now have emerging of the feeling that photography is an art form. It's not merely a documentary form, but it's high art, and that your name doesn't have to be Cézanne to be considered an artist. And Chansonetta merges those two, the documenting of New England as it was, together with that documentation presented as a work of art. Not just a picture postcard of a covered bridge, but no, a picture which is composed, lighted, arranged, whatever, as a painter would do with a canvas. Dorothy gives her whole life to Mother. If Mother was pretty, Dorothy was beautiful. She came to believe in her mind that Mother was a great talent, and therefore everything she did should be for Mother's benefit. And so she became Mother's gopher. She carried Mother's lunch pocket, and Mother's purse, and Mother's camera, and Mother's tripod, and whatever, walking across the stream while Mother's standing there with dry feet. The picture exists. Boyfriends would come to the door, and Dorothy would say, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mommy wants me to do something or other." And then suitors would come to the door later on, and she would say, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mother and I have to go to the Berkshires on a photography trip." And so Dorothy had no life of her own outside of Mother until Mother died. But they were an interesting pair. You can ask me questions about the hard of hearing bit afterwards if you're not all bored and falling asleep. The time passes. She gets old like all of us. Ray Stanley is Effie Stanley's only son. And there are many pictures of Ray and Dorothy together because they were the same age and the same size. And Chansonetta used them very often as playmate pictures or brother and sister playmate pictures. And she writes to Ray in the 30s about she's at wit's end, she's going mad, she's going to lose all her mental capacities. There's this problem with Dorothy's illness, it's just going to kill me, I know. And this goes on and on over a period of letters, over a period of time. And if Dorothy had had an appendix or adenoids or a sore throat or an earache, I'm sure Chansonetta would have said this. The fact that she talks only of Dorothy's medical problems makes me think it's a female medical problem. because especially when you remember that Chansonetta was a perfect Victorian lady years after the Victorian era had passed. People remember her to the day of her death wearing black alpaca to the floor. That was the predominant image of her. And picture that in 1935 with a dress like that, more or less. But I don't think she ever showed her ankle in her life. She was a very proper lady. Well, anyway, finally, Dorothy goes into the hospital. She comes home. She recuperates, which is very lengthy, but Chansonetta is very much relieved. Then she writes a letter to Ray saying, I'm getting old. I'm forgetting things. It's amazing how many things I've accumulated. I've got to take all my glass plate negatives, and I've got to make a record print of everything for posterity. I will never allow anybody to touch my negatives, because they don't know what I want to get out of them. And that's very true, especially today. If you pick up any of these pictures, please do so on the edges, because the acid in your fingers will damage them. Here is, you can't see it, but come up and look at it after. Here is her picture of the Reverend Emery Butts in his table chair. Now, we had the negative for that, and we had a very professional photographer print it up. And if you can get out of the fact it's also enlarged, there is no way today that we can approximate what she did. The printing paper that she used, which is old-fashioned Kodak Velux, exists no longer. Maybe the word still exists as a trademark, but it doesn't have what Velux used to have. And Bernice Abbott complained about this too. This used to be loaded with silver. In fact, if you look at this image of it in her book here, and you look, hold this at the light in just the right way, you feel you're looking at a silver plate. And over the years, as silver got more expensive, Kodak kept dropping the amount of silver in the emulsion, and so that the Velux that I used in the 50s was nothing like the Velux that Chansonetta used. And so there's no way we can recreate that sepia-ish, silvery tone that she obtained. Well, anyway, where was I? So she apparently starts on this record print process, but she never completes it. She's run out of energy. I take one last trip up the St. Lawrence River, and she comes back, and she dies in her bed in Newton, at the age of 79, I think. Dorothy inherits everything. Enough glass plates to make a greenhouse a quarter of a mile long, is the way Ray Stanley did it. And you can imagine what this weighed. You know, you've got all these 5x7 glass plates, pieces of glass, plus thousands and thousands of prints in steamer trunks. And Dorothy, as I said, believed that Mother was a great talent. And so she tries to carry on the torch and tries to get somebody interested in publishing Mother's photographs, which doesn't happen, and which is a long story as to how it finally ended up in our hands to do the book. As I say, if you're not all asleep after the slideshow, you can ask me about the sad and tragic life of Dorothy Emmons. Well, as I said, she bridges an interesting period in American photography. I think you may be all aware of Wallace Nutting or Sawyer or some of the other people who were doing photographs at that time. And at first glance, you may think there is a relationship, but please don't delude yourself. There is no relationship. Wallace Nutting got his subjects, or models, what you want to call them, dressed up in ye early American colonial costume, or at least what he thought was ye early American colonial costume, and tried to recreate a colonial look in a colonial parlor, like, say, the Moses Mason House. Chansonetta was doing a very true-to-life look at 19th century New England, even though she was a couple of decades too late. By her selectiveness, by her ability to find the right models, she could recreate a Maine or a Connecticut or a Western Massachusetts of 1870 to 1880 or even 1890 in 1920. So she had a completely different focus than Wallace Nutting or Sawyer. It was not a nostalgic look. It may have some romantic feeling in terms of the spinning wheel or the loom or even the horse. But it is also a true-to-life picture of the hardship of farm life, basically farm life. Until we go to the Carolinas, she's never taken a picture of a city. It's interesting, she never took a picture of her brother's great mansions in Newton. She never took a picture of Boston. She never took a picture of anybody else. Well, she went to a Glunkwood many times on her way to Kingfield. They'd stay over, that was the first night's stop, in a Glunkwood. And then there are no pictures of a Glunkwood at the height of the tourist era. She was a rural girl trying to preserve the rural look. And so she's trying to accomplish something different. She's also, except for two other female photographers, quite alone in her outlook. There's nobody else doing quite what she did until you get to the WPA days, in which we have photographers looking at the Dust Bowl and the hardship of rural life out west, or the hardship of life in the mills, and things of that sort. But she is giving you a fairly true-to-life picture of hardship. Okay, now the slides. Obviously, these are not her slides. They're in a Kodak, what irony, Harris does. But she put together these slideshows to earn money, as I said. They come in beautiful little mahogany boxes with a lot of little slots to keep them from jostling against each other. There are no titles. It just says Chansonetta Stanley Emmons, 21 Newton Street, Bennington Street, Newton. We don't know what the title of it is. I think you can dream up your own title. It's either looking back at the New England of our ancestors, or a backward glance of stalwart New England, or something of that sort. It really doesn't matter that we don't have a title. They're all numbered 1 to 103. They're all captions and legend, so that we know exactly what she's showing us. You're not going to see 103. I use my editorial discretion to pull out the hollyhocks. My mother grew hollyhocks, and Chansonetta grew hollyhocks, and I'm sick and tired of hollyhocks. So you'll see two hollyhocks, but that's it. But I think the slideshow was expandable and retractable anyway. If she spoke before at AAUW, she would put in the hollyhocks. If she spoke before a Masonic group of men, she would pull out the hollyhocks. I mean, I think she did this anyway. And so I have done it. And I've added a few images, which it's interesting that all the images in the slideshow don't necessarily survive as black and white images or as negatives. In fact, we had some negatives for which we had no print. For instance, this little one of Marjorie Warren, we had no print of that. We had, in the book, we had to make the print. So, anyway, let's go on and look at the slides. You're probably seeing these better than Chansonetta's BPW ladies saw them, because the light source is much better than the old magic lantern, and the lens is 1,000 times better than the old magic lantern. So you're probably seeing them better than her audiences. This one I added. Am I in your way, sir?
Slightly. Just slightly.
I added this just to see. Here she is in 1904. F.E. or an F.O. have given her the money to buy a 1904 century camera, and she's looking in a mirror, taking her herself, setting off on her new career as a photographer, professional photographer. We owned the camera at one time, and it was as beautiful when we got it as the day she bought it. She took very good care of it. It was a very beautiful and quite expensive camera. Interestingly, and I make this a snide male remark, she did touch up her complexion a little bit. The only slide we ever have of her touching up anything. So, oh vanity, thy name is woman. Okay, ready. We had this also. It's a little round thing that hung on the wall. Here's Chansonetta and Dorothy. Again, at some indeterminate age. I don't know how old Dorothy is here, but mid-teens maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. Here's the camera. All mahogany and gleaming brass. And she used this to the day she died. She never used really, she borrowed other cameras to fool around with, but this was the camera she used to the day she died. Okay? Okay, here's number one. As I say, these are in her order. Now, why is this number one? It's, well, I think we can conjecture that it's her image of the typical New England village.
embodies everything that in the Wayward Village was or is, including the Elm Trees. This is North New Portland. She probably spent as much time with friends and relatives in North New Portland, or the New Portlands, as in Kingfield. Now, this is now bypassed if you're going skiing at Sugarloaf. Sugarloaf. You don't have to go into downtown New Portland. But here is the bridge across Lemon Stream, which furnishes the power for the grist mill here, and the blacksmith shop back here. And this is beautifully composed. I'm not going to do this for every slide, but this is her training as an artist and why these are works of art. She has used a very common painter's technique of diagonals to focus your attention on where she wants you to see. The diagonal of the branch, the diagonal of the road, the diagonal of the road, the diagonal of the roof lines, this roof line. Everything to point your eye to the man on the bridge and why. Well, you can't tell because she's colored it in a way that you can't tell, but he's a black man. And so this is the interest of the story, is of what's a black man doing in North New Portland? But anyway, that's the picture. Now you see North New Portland Village going down the road with bustling millinery shops, ship leather harness shops, another blacksmith shop, and so forth, and of course, beautiful trees. Now the next slide I took standing at just about the same place Chansonetta was.
Wow.
And this house is still here, but you can see what's happened to North New Portland. Well, of course, the power lines are not attractive. Now, I'm not saying she was against electricity, heaven forbid, but she just realized it was a change that she didn't want to acknowledge. And of course, you see rusting roofs and houses broken up into apartments and all that sort of mess. Okay. Now, this is the inside of the blacksmith shop that you just saw. Now some of these slides stayed in a damp basement for a while, and there was a little bit of damage on some of them, but not much. Now her trick here is to stand in the great big door that every blacksmith shop had, so she's got her light in back of her, flooding the inside of the blacksmith shop. But she's got to contend with the light coming in the window right into her lens. So this is a very good example of her being able to dodge, as photographers would use the word, dodge the light when she prints her prints to compensate for too much light coming into her lens. Now, Randy or Stan, or even you members of historical societies, would be interested to see here the New Portland Sun. Until we published this picture, and it's much clearer in the book, nobody knew that there was a New Portland Sun, which shows how ephemeral ephemera is. So if anybody ever finds an issue of the New Portland Sun in the bottom of the trunk, send it to the University of Maine or somewhere, Maine Historical, because it doesn't survive. We don't know when it started, we don't know when it ended, we don't know if it was a weekly, a monthly, or what. So but anyway, now, the man here with the anvil, he is not dropping that anvil. She is saying, hold it, 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000, 4-1000. Same thing with the man with the paper. Okay, hold that paper. 1-1000, 2-1. Try doing that. Try to hold a newspaper without shaking, you know? These are very long exposure times because she never used a flash or any artificial light. It was always natural light. She was a master of it. But it did result in long exposure times. And you had to have very understanding models. But so anyway, this is the male bonding in the blacksmith shop. Okay? Now, here, as opposed to the one using diagonals, she has used the trick of circles. The little boy looking in, the curve of the back leg, the curve of the man, the horse's curve, everything to focus your attention on putting on the horseshoe. That's the purpose of the whole story. These are all picture stories. Now, they're hard for us to put ourselves into them today because there are no more blacksmith shops. But to her generation, these immediately evoked all sorts of stories because everybody had been in a blacksmith shop, had known a blacksmith, had known a little boy, had known a fractious horse. If this was a fractious horse, it doesn't look like it, but you know what I'm trying to say, okay? Now, here's a very close picture, and try and picture this one in your mind and hold it. Try and look at the quilt
back, look at the wallpaper pattern, at the lamp, some of the things on the wall here, the braided rug. This is Aunt, this is Hazel True's mother, grandmother, and of course nobody would put up a spinning wheel in front of three doors opening in all different directions. This is a very posed picture. The spinning wheel was brought down from the attic, and grandmother, who was suitably old enough to have maybe used a spinning wheel, is told to pretend. And again, this is just a posed picture of the 19th century, taken in 1905 or somewhere like that. Okay. Now, here is Moses Mitchell, his son, and little Hazel True. And I had the honor to meet Hazel True before she died, and got a lot of stories from her about Chansonetta. She's one of Chansonetta's favorite models. This is the gristmill that you saw in that first slide. Now, the story that Hazel told me is that, well, of course, there's an elixir sign up here, and you know elixirs were killed to death by what, the 1906 Pure Food and Drug Act or something. So we know it's after that. The feeling of dust permeates everything, the feeling that this is an old mill, the window is boarded up, and it's a posed picture again. She called up Moses, or she called, she talked to Moses and said, would you open the mill for me? The mill had been closed for 10 or 15 years, thanks to the Washington brothers, who had driven him out of business. And he says, what for? And she says, I want to take a picture with Hazel and your son. All right. So William, I think it's William, fills these old grain bags with, I think it was black walnut shell or something, to pretend. And they go down there and they pretend. And of course, Hazel is in absolute awe at this wonderful beard, this venerable old man. I mean, just the look on her eyes is just wonderful. But anyway, it's a picture to evoke the past that really didn't exist at this time. And wonderful composition here. Okay. This is Lucy Bus Carville. She's a widow by this time. I think we would agree she's the indomitable Yankee woman of all time, the pioneer spirit, the overcome all obstacles and hell be damned type of woman. Now, remember, there is no color film here. Every one of these slides has to be painted by hand by Chansonetta. And these are using her miniaturist skills. Every little hair is a brush stroke. Every tone or shade or wrinkle, whatever, is all painted by hand. I guess I didn't show you that lantern slide, did I? This is what the lantern slides look like. They're 3x4 glass slides. What she had to do was to take her 5x7 glass plate negative, reduce it to a 3x4 positive, because obviously we're projecting a positive image on here. Then she had to hand paint every part of that emotion, black it, back it with another piece of glass, bind it with tape, and then you were done. Okay. Here's her brother, the Reverend Emery Butts, who preached hell and brimstone in church on Sunday and worked his farm the other 5 or 6 days of the week. Again, just a picture of great strength. Sort of a Yankee icon. Okay. Now here is Reverend Emery and his wife, and Lucy the widow is now living with them, living with her brother and her sister-in-law. Again, the door has been brought out to the door of the porch so that you get light, and it's sitting in front of another door, which has obviously been moved. The whole thing is set up. This is just damage in the emulsion here. I think Mrs. Butts has put on a Sears Roebuck bought dress, but Aunt Lucy's going to care less. She's just going to be Aunt Lucy. You can see a brown bread here. You can see a Portland glass goblet. You can see a ruby thumbprint right there. They're wonderful images. She's posed these. She's put the tablecloth on the way it should be, and she's done things for Sunday lunch that probably they wouldn't have done if she hadn't been there. Okay. Now here's another gristmill. The other one was a horizontal composition. This one is a much more striking vertical composition. And she didn't do too many verticals. But the tension of the man climbing up the stairs, the diagonal coming down, going up there, the beam coming back in, the man looking down, just a great composition, all sorts of wonderful forms down here, all rounded forms that reflect the roundness of the wheel housing. And a notice to the selectmen or the people of, I think this is Connecticut or Rhode Island. Okay. All New England states are in here except Rhode Island. She did take pictures in Rhode Island, but she didn't put them in the slideshow. The slideshow selection is sort of odd. Some of what we think of her greatest pictures are not in here. So she's telling us a story that doesn't require some of what we think of her best work. Here's a loom that had been in the attic and was brought back down and reassembled and whatever you call. And this lady still remembered how to do it. You see the Courier and Eyes up on the wall, which is sort of unusual considering that we're now in the 1920s. Just looking at wallpaper patterns in these pictures is also interesting. The spinning wheel over here, very plain plank back chair here. It's again an industry that's gone by, but let's preserve it. We know who all these people are, but I'm not gonna bore you. Okay, right. This is a series of five that she did called The Old Table Chair. And I have the picture book, which she did. She gave this away as a Christmas gift. It's called The Old Table Chair. It's got her artwork on it and the five old table chair pictures series in it. She didn't put all five in here, but she put, I think, two or three. Here is the table chair empty. And again, you've got the circle, the circle, the circle, the circle, the circle, the circle, a vertical, a vertical, a vertical, a vertical. It's all beautifully painted. Okay? Now here's Reverend Emery Butts sitting in the chair. And we notice things have been changed. We've got a milk can. The broom has been slanted a different direction to bring your eye in. Okay. You're out on a porch here. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Okay, now here's, no, that's all right. You're out on an outside porch. We'll get back to it. Now here's the same room that you saw with the spinning wheel. And this is Hazel True's mother. What's happened to the room? Well, the wallpaper is different. The kerosene lamp is gone. This throw is different. This is different. Of course, there's a cat here now. There's part of a flax wheel here, and we now have brought the old claw clock down from the attic and put it in front of the door. And the table chair is now down and set for a meal, and there's a different braided rug. This is the little closet that she used as a dark room when she was with the Trues in North New Portland. Now, today you just go to, well, today you go to Rite Aid and give me a film, but in my day you had trays and chemicals, and you just poured these things into a certain amount and you develop your pictures. But in her day, she had to go to a drugstore and ask for X number of grams of this or X of this, and she had to mix all her own chemicals. And of course, there was no running water to wash her prints or negatives, and so little Hazel's keep running in with buckets of water into the house to wash Chansonetta's prints. So printing was not easy in those days. Okay. Now here are Ray Stanley and Dorothy. No, this is Hazel, sorry. Hazel sitting in the table chair, which has been moved up closer to this very interesting well, which is inside the porch, so that in the wintertime you don't have to go to the well outside. You can get your water from underneath the porch. And you have the fruits of the harvest here at their feet. Okay. And here's another of the table chair series. This is Aunt Lucy Butts Carville. I think she's shelling, I think it's called shelling peas. I'm not sure, but anyway, again, the half-cut melon or squash, corn, I think, apples, the blue bucket again, and you're now seeing interesting little forms back here on the shelves. The broom has been moved and so forth. These are all taken over a different period of time, obviously. They're all part of a vision in her mind of how the table chair could be used. Okay? Now, wouldn't we like to find an attic like this today? In fact, Randy has offered to take us upstairs here, and he's got price tags on everything, and just make them an offer. But this is called up attic, obviously. And it looks like a mumble jumble, but it isn't. She and Hazel spent about a day and a half arranging everything. This is arranged, believe it or not. You've got the round clock face, it's lost its hands, that's why it's in the attic. You've got the hat very strategically propped against the broken arm to show that it's broken, and it's reflecting this circle, and another circle here, and a sort of an oval here, and a basket which is tipping in so that your eye doesn't wander around. You've got rounds here, a little round there in the handle. And of course you've got drying red corn, another round shape up there. Just a beautifully posed picture, seemingly on the spur of the moment, but it wasn't. Civil War crutches. Okay, Ben. I added this one because I love it. Because this is what Chansonetta could have become, a widow in a little back room at her parents' house. This was the lot of a widow. Come back home, we'll take care of you. You won't get much space, but you can help out. You took care of widowed sisters or widowed mothers. That was the way, but don't be extravagant about it. Now, she was the wife of a doctor, and you can tell this from her beautiful dress that shimmers, but she's and confined into this little space that she can close off at night with draperies. It doesn't show down there at the end, but these were probably the fine drapes from one of the windows of her fine home before her husband died. She's sitting there. Okay. Now, here is the sort of the beginning. I should flip these two slides because, again, wallpaper is interesting. What the art is interesting. But here is the old mother and her three daughters. And I think you can tell which one was married to the doctor, which one was the spinster who took care of her mother in her old age and gave up her own life for mother, and which one was the school teacher. You can see the personalities in these, especially if we were of an older generation. These people would be very recognizable to us by their dress, their demeanor, their look, their attitude, whatever. It's a wonderful generational picture. Okay, here's Hazel in one of the best pictures that Chansonetta liked. Hazel was very proud to be in it. And she said, Hazel would say, I'm proud of it if I don't have to tell you the story of how it came about. And let me tell you the story as quickly as I can. The night before, Chansonetta said, Hazel, I want to get a picture of you throwing scratch feed out to the chickens. Hazel said, okay. Now, she said, Hazel, I want you to do your hair up like it was at church on Sunday. And I want you to wear that nice little red dress that you wore to Mrs. So-and-so's. And that nice shiny pair of shoes. And we're going to have Andy the cat in the picture. And so, of course, everybody gets ready for the next morning. This is all dependent on the weather, of course. Well, the weather cooperates. So, father is up at 5:30, feeds the cows or milks the cows or whatever. So that by 6:30 he's back in, they all have breakfast, and at 7:30 they're out. The first thing is that Andy does not cooperate. Cats don't like to cooperate. And so he runs away, and Chansonetta sighs and says, all right, we'll do without Andy. And then Hazel is left-handed, and she's throwing the scratch feed out, and it's going over here against this well cover, and Chansonetta doesn't like that. She wants her to throw it out with the right hand. So Hazel is practicing throwing scratch feed out with her right hand. And of course, she's not doing it very well, so father has to come and sweep up all this scratch feed, which is all over the place. Well, they practice this, and she gets it down. Okay, now we get the chickens in here, because we know, again, chickens don't like to cooperate. Well, they had two different kinds of chickens to make a nice composition. But one of the kinds, I think these are barred rocks, aren't they?
Plymouth rocks.
Plymouth rocks? Okay. Well, they had some other chickens anyway, Rhode Island Reds or something. And the Rhode Island Reds would just run away. These were the only tranquil ones. So this is now 9 o'clock. We started at 7:30, we're now at 9 o'clock. And Chansonetta all of a sudden realizes she doesn't like the way the sun is casting a shadow on something or other. So they all go back into the house and they wait a half an hour. And they go out, and the sun is all right. And by this time, Andy has cooperated and come back out and looked like a nice, well-mannered little kitten. And at 10:15, Hazel says, I remember that date is etched in my mind. At 10:15, we finally took the picture. Starting at 7:30. Now, there are probably likely stories like this behind all of the pictures. We just don't have the story. That's how meticulous she was. Okay. Here is Lemon Stream, here is the blacksmith shop, and here is the grist mill. You're looking at it from another direction. And we have supposedly kids playing in the brook, but we all have these sort of country kids. But there's Dorothy in her Newton best hat and frilly dress. Now, there's a little bit of humor here, which I don't know if Chansonetta would have pointed it out to a lady at the time. But what is Dorothy looking at the little boy doing in the ring? Anyway, it's a nice picture. You could see she worked with kids extremely well. She could get them to do what she was an imposing enough a figure, and authoritative enough, and yet kind enough that she could get kids to do this and hold their poles. All right, now to us, this is not an unusual picture, but to people in the Newton area, especially, again, women's groups who had no rural background, this would have been a very touching little picture. This is the emulsion flaking off the plate. Okay. Let's say, I don't think it's a great picture, but she put it in here for some reason. Now, this is one of the few pictures in which she censored it herself. Up here, looking over the fence, is Dorothy. In a great big hat and a big starched white lace something, and she looks about 15 or 16, and obviously as she got older, she was sort of ashamed of herself, and she had mother cut her out. But again, that's not the point. I think the point of the picture is that on a farm, a sow who could give you that many piglets in the spring was a sign of fruitfulness, fecundity, a life will continue all as well with the farm. I'm sorry, I keep getting in front of you here. Okay. This one Bernice Abbott liked very much, so I just put it in. Here you've got the little dog looking in, and you've got two children playing with kittens. Okay. All right. This young girl unfortunately died young, Marjorie Warren, but I suppose that she was a tomboy who liked blue jeans and other things, and she obviously is very unhappy to have to get dressed up with a stupid bouquet of flowers and those red stockings, those polished shoes, and that dress, which she would rather be climbing trees in her dungarees. But anyway, that's Marjorie Warren. Okay. Of course, her film speeds did not allow her to stop hardly any motion until the very end of her life when the films are changing. So this putting it up here is not just putting it up here. It's putting it off and holding it, hold it, hold it. And this is Hazel True's father, his son, who hopefully will carry on the farm, the hired man, or two hired men. And then just to fill this void down in here, she's arranged it that there's another horse team down there. Of course, oxen were much preferred because they were more docile. Okay. This, I love this one, with the light dappling in through the hayloft at the top. And again, the car has arrived. I think this is evocative in that the carriage has been put away. It may never go out again. I don't know, but it's just a feeling of time passing. The wheelbarrow, the grinding wheel, and some other things. But just the hay coming down is just a very pretty picture. Okay? This is 34, 35. By this time, the dry plate had disappeared. We now have sheet film, celluloid film. And film speeds are getting a little faster. So she could stop the motion. This is his ox pulling at the Farmington Fair. But I mean, again, picture her in her black dress to the ground out there in the midst of all this. Okay. This guy obviously could not afford a set of false teeth, but he's happy anyway. This is the New Portland Fair, and of course you can see the little joke here
her, his prize mushrooms or prize something are being eaten while he doesn't know it. Okay. It's obviously fall, you can tell from the foliage. Okay. These are not in any sequence. This is one of the first pictures she took, but she didn't put it first because it doesn't fit into whatever she's telling us. This is Aunt Abigail and Aunt Hannah in Kingfield. They're relatives of hers. And this is one of her first great genre photographs. Interestingly, by the time she went back to Newton, within that year, both Aunt Abigail and Aunt Hannah were dead. And it's a sort of, she had captured widow, here she is, a new widow, capturing old widows at the very end. And it tells you a great deal about widowhood. Okay? But an interesting interior, you know. You just look at all the details, just a wonderful interior things to look at, okay? She tried to do some, shall I call them, Renoir-ish photographs. Just pure art, pure impressionist light, capturing what the French impressionist and American impressionist were trying to do in painting. I mean, not that she had been trained to be a painter. And so there are a number of pictures of this sort, which are merely moods, merely light moods, moods of light. This is on Stanley Hill, in back of one stand of Stanley Avenue in Kingfield. If you want to see how prosperous her brothers became, go to Stanley Avenue and look at the mansions. Well, they're Kingfield mansions. Okay. In fact, if you eat at one Stanley Avenue, a very fine restaurant, you're in a Stanley house. Okay, this is a series which is not all in the slideshow, but is in the book. And it's in a Vermont kitchen. Notice that the stove is so low that it's been put up on blocks. I mean, I think any woman would have broken her back trying to cook on that stove if they hadn't put it on blocks. I don't know what the designer was thinking of. But obviously the lady has put on her best, or worst, hat and come call. This is female bonding in the morning and come for a cup of coffee or tea. I guess that's a teapot, right? Yeah. Notice the shade made of wallpaper, the unpainted kitchen walls, the wood box, and so forth. Okay. Of course, you can study these too for just dress, textiles, and so forth. This one has suffered some damage, but here you are to the left of the stove. Here the husband has finished his day's work, he's reading the newspaper, and the wife, who absolutely towers over him, is doing her knitting. Nice little Indian basket up here. Notice the shade is up and we now have a curtain here, and so forth. There's another one in between here, there's a third picture in this series, in the middle of the day. Okay. Okay, this is the picture that, according to Laura Abbott, which doesn't mean anything to you, had a light bulb up here. And she hung this thing instead to make it look older than it was. This is emulsion damage here. It shows you the idea of growing plants in the window is nothing new. You don't have to have an Anderson window, bay window to do that. This lady looks black, or at least mulatto. I've never really quite figured it out. It's certainly not a four-generation picture because these two ladies could not be mother and daughter. I mean, I think this is mother, daughter, and grandchild. This may be a hired woman. I don't know. I've puzzled about it. But again, you have all the details of the closed-up fireplace and the new cast iron stove, or relatively new cast iron stove. Of course, you know Mount Abrams towers over Kingfield, and much venerated. Here's Kingfield Church and smoke down in the valley. She's up on Stanley Hill looking out over Kingfield during a storm. And when you think this is a painting, you realize how beautifully she's painted it. Now, the thing is, she could do things like this. She could take a rather mundane sky and by painting it, give you a storm. She necessarily didn't have to have a storm. She didn't necessarily have to have fall foliage. She, you know, she could exercise artistic license, as we would call it. Okay. Here's another one of those mood pictures that I think is called The Great Patriarch or something, an old pine tree that she had probably known as a child up on Stanley Hill, and it's still there. Okay. This could be rather mundane, kids under an apple blossom tree, but again, by the way they're looking in different directions and doing different things and some smiling and some not, she's given you a fairly interesting picture. And of course the pun is in the title, which is young blossoms, young apple blossoms, young children. Okay. Everybody likes this one. I think you can tell which one is the naughty little boy, and which one is the prissy little girl, and which one is just extremely curious and lovable. This is very common of the period, these sort of cutesy pictures. But everybody liked them. They sold very well, and I'm sure that she knew what her audience was. And if she could sell 10 of these as opposed to one of something else, she would print them up. And of course, there is some talent involved in getting three kittens to do what you want them to do. Obviously, they're dangling something up there, at least for one of them to look at. Okay. This is Winter. I don't know if you know, was it Winter's Inn, the great Winter House in Kingfield, with the great sawmill that used to be in Kingfield. This is the son of Amos Winter. Rich family, so obviously the pampered little boy could have his pampered little miniature oxen for his own little cart to do his own little chores. What a well little brought up boy was taught to do for daddy. Okay. This one, again, everybody likes. I hate to discourage anybody who's Jewish, that is not a yarmulke. That's what's left of Daddy's straw hat. I don't think, I sort of like it better in black and white, frankly, because I don't think you need the color to tell you that he's a blue-eyed, blonde-haired bundle of mischief. It's not bad this way, but look at it in black and white. I think you'll like it just as well. This is over in New Hampshire. She did a lot of photography around Chesham and Harrisonville, New Hampshire. Okay, there was a summer colony there. Okay, now as I say, these are picture stories. She's asking you to put yourself into them. And this is a perfect example. Now Randy, you still here, Randy?
I'm still here.
Okay, still awake. Okay, now Randy has taught in a one-room schoolhouse.
I knew you'd say that.
I put this in especially for you.
Thank you.
But Randy can associate with this picture on a level that you and I can't, because we've only been students. And there's a difference. Now, again, there are many things you can read into this, depending, again, on your own life. Were you the teacher's pet and didn't wander too far away from her? Were you ever homesick and told to go home? Were you naughty and told to go home? You know, this all depends on your personal experiences. So you could, every one of us can read this in a different way. And, of course, I've always wondered from this, did she ever see Winslow Homer's painting Snap the Whip? I don't know. This is Vermont. Okay. This is another one of those up attic pictures. Again, very posed with the shoes right in the light and the musket leaning there strategically and the light hitting the wheel and the curve. Again, she loved curves, as you can tell, but she's worked it into the diagonal of the roof line. So just a very pretty picture of the Shrew's attic. Okay. This is Laura Abbott's mother. She was a school teacher in Kingfield, and Laura told me that in Mother's Day, this was considered the uniform for school teachers. I don't know, Randy, if this is right or not, but she always said that the high button blouse, white blouse, the French gray broadcloth skirt with the black belt was sort of de rigueur for a school teacher. Here are some hollyhocks, ladies. Real quick, very interesting well in which you turn a woman doesn't have to lift up the rope. You turn a much more easy
crank, where the water comes out at the bottom. And of course, the hair in the bun was also part of the school teacher bit. So it's a nice picture. That amazingly, that well still survives. That Laura still owns the house. Okay. Here are the hollyhocks, and you can get a feel for what they look like. They're very beautiful. They're very pretty. She also loved roses. She had favorite rose gardens. Okay. Now here's the picture that is not a historical document, it's pure art. The Dewey Spiderweb. It was Dorothy's favorite picture. I think it's a tour de force, not in photography, but in terms of painting it. Okay. Again, this is like the pig picture. The old mare, no matter how old and sway back, if she can give you a young colt every year or whenever, I don't know how often colts come, but anyway, it is a valuable part of your farm. And so it's again that renewal of life story. Young children, young pigs, young colts, new flowers, okay? Well, of course, to the ladies and gentlemen of Newton, Massachusetts, this would have been a titter-titter, oh, isn't that cute picture? Because they'd never seen anything like this. Too many of us have lived on a farm. That's just standard operating procedure. But anyway, it's a nice picture. Okay. All right, here's a very pretty vertical composition. I don't have to tell you about the rug and the churn and the plate on the walls and so forth. You'll see this room in another location, another viewpoint in a minute. But again, nobody was making butter this way anymore. But let's pretend. Okay. Here's Ward Doblier, the last Civil War veteran in Kingfield. And because of her brother and just because of the veneration of the veterans, he was a great man. They were all great men in the opinion of later generations. And Memorial Day was a big thing. And so she has preserved him in all his aging glory. Okay. Now, here's her brother Isaac, husking corn. You notice that all the corn is red, you know, this sweet yellow stuff that we eat. Because they did different things with corn. They didn't eat it on the cob as we do. A lot of nice baskets in there. I wish we had them. Good picture. All right. Again, this is a story series. Go ahead, Randy. Here is husking. Husking shelling. This is shelling the corn. Here are the ears down here, which he is shelling and putting into this old measure. Here is Dorothy down here using the corn cobs to build a little house or something. This is what they called at the time Rembrandt lighting. In other words, the light just sort of dapples on the top of everything that it wants to hit, and everything else is very dark. Now, we had the negative. We could have printed the negative, and she could have printed the negative with every oil can, every mason jar, every hammer, every screwdriver hanging from all of these beams. It's all there. But she printed it in this way, by again dodging the light coming in here, holding it back, and letting just the importance show. Now this is not her talent as a photographer. This is her talent as a printer of her negatives. And someone else would not know this. This is why she didn't want anybody to touch her negatives. This is a very common feeling among photographers. Okay. I don't put this in to shock you, but merely to show you there's more to her than just rural life. Gulick, what's his first name? A progressive thinker of the beginning of the century who had a camp, Luther, thank you. You're younger, your memory's better than mine. He had a camp on the shores of Lake Sebago in which, let's put it, some freedom was allowed. And this is not a picture of two nude women and a baby, but rather a picture of maternal love. Take my word for it. I'm pretty sure I'm right in this, that she is not glorifying the female nude in any way. She is merely showing two ladies of a movement that existed that she was not part of, but was aware of, and which had no stigma attached to it, if you believe as Luther Girl did. So, anyway, okay. But can we go back, Andy, or Randy, on that? Here you can see her signature, Chansonetta S. Emmons. Okay. All right. This one exists as an oil painting. She never gave up oil painting completely. But the problem was that the attention for detail, the opening up the back of her camera, putting that cloth over her and saying, Hazel, do this. Hazel, do that. Let's get every little detail right. Let's wait for the sun. This great desire to control, which made her a good photographer, made her overpaint her paintings. She couldn't leave well enough alone. She'd go back to it and back to it and touch it up again. And so her paintings are not that good. But anyway, again, it's harvest. Nature regenerates. Okay. This is part of the corn series. Here we're grinding the corn. This is one of the few that she censored herself. There's a beer bottle on the box over here, and obviously this would not have been suitable for showing to ladies' groups in the Boston area, so the beer bottle gets cut out. Okay. Here is Uncle Isaac. Again, an inside well. Very difficult with light coming from everywhere. This is a beautifully printed picture. Okay. Here's Ma Abrams in a snowstorm. Sometimes she would hold Dorothy out of school in the fall so they could see foliage in an early fall, an early snow. But a wonderful slash, a diagonal of snow that leads you into Kingfield down below and the mountain. Very pretty picture. Dorothy painted this, and it's interesting, it's ironic in a way, that Dorothy became a better painter than her mother. Okay. Of course, you could not take night scenes, so this is completely fake. If you have ever lived by kerosene lamp, you know that no kerosene lamp will throw that much light. I mean, it looks like the house is burning up. But I mean, the city folk, they wouldn't know the difference. So she's faked up a daytime scene to look like a nighttime scene. This is the Vos family homestead in Kingfield, okay? Here's again a generational picture you learned from grandmother. With grandfather looking down at you from the wall, even though he's dead, and of course, from the size of the book, it must be the Bible. I feel sorry for this little boy because I had a Unifilm like that once as a kid. But anyway, pay attention to your elders. All sorts of knowledge comes from them. There's a lot of morality, of course, in these pictures. Okay? And we are now at the last slide. Why is this the climax of her slideshow? Well, I think. For two reasons. First of all, because of her dress, because of the tripod, because of the camera, and the weight of the glass plates, getting out in the snow was difficult. And I think she impressed on her audience how difficult it was. Now, to us, this is nothing. To her, it was a big deal. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Maris. Anyone have any questions for Maris?
Yes. My question has to do with the hand colorist. The young blossoms was reminiscent of Lost Island.
Mm-hmm.
And Patriarch, mm-hmm, of Fred Thompson.
Mm-hmm.
And,
well, a lot of
Abraham.
Oh, yeah.
Charles Sawyer. Was she aware of contemporaries?
She must have been.
Was she looking for a commercial niche that they hadn't hit yet?
I don't think she ever expected to carve out a great commercial niche. I think her vision to herself and being true to whatever she wanted to do was more important than trying to copy a trend or a fad or something.
Was all of her hand coloring done on these actual slides, not on a
paper? This stuff, not on the label.
And what did she color them with?
Well, oils. Most miniaturists use oils. Some use watercolors, but she would not have. The watercolor doesn't dry very well on glass.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, any other questions? Is everybody thoroughly bored, or do you want me to tell you about the rest of the story very quickly?
The rest of the story.
Okay. Dorothy takes all these glass plates and puts them in steamer trunks. And FO had built Estes Park, the great resort hotel in Colorado, which still survives. And FO says, you can have a free room out there, just tell them who you are, go out there, get over Mama's death. She goes out there, and here's Dorothy now, a little long in years, but still a very beautiful girl. And all of a sudden, she falls in love. And this is a lady who's had no social experience at all. And she, like her mother, is a real love match. This guy is a real nice guy. They get married, but unfortunately, he's from California. Well, he wants her, of course, to go back to California. So she takes all these glass plates and prints and the steamer trunks and ships them out to California. Well, she was as fated as her mother, because her love of her life dies in 2 years. And so here's Dorothy out in this strange land with all these steamer trunks. And she's trying to get people interested in publishing mother's pictures. Well, it doesn't work. So she comes back. Well, first of all, so then she meets another man whose name I cannot mention. It's in the book, if you want to look it up. A real SOB. He was a minister on Sunday, and a real bad guy on the other 6 days of the week. He marries Dorothy, and they come back, and he takes a church on Main Street in Farmington. And Dorothy starts showing up at bridge clubs with black eyes, where Dorothy is seen in the store with an ankle or with a bruise on her arm. And everybody knows what's going on, but of course, things were not as enlightened in the 40s as they are today. Well, Dorothy dies, finally, after this very unhappy experience. And Ray Stanley and other members of the family, basically Ray is the only close relative, comes to the funeral. And this reverend says to Ray, of course, Ray comes up as a Boston funeral. He's wearing spats, he's wearing a top hat and gloves and tails. I mean, did he stand out in Farmington? Let me tell you, he did. But he came dressed, as one should, properly brought up rich boy, for a funeral. And so here he is dressed like this. And as they come out of the church and the body is being taken to the cemetery, the reverend comes up to him and says, I don't want any of that Stanley or Emma's material in my house beyond tonight. If you don't take it, it's going to the dump. And so Ray takes off his spats and rolls up his sleeves, and he goes up in the attic, and here are these steamer trunks, full of stuff. I mean, not only pictures, but family mementos of the Stanleys and so forth. And there's a window at the end of this attic, and he takes a glass plate, good, puts it over here. Not so good, puts it over there. He knows he can't take everything. He's got about half an hour to make a selection out of thousands and thousands of prints and negatives. And so he takes 5 or 6 trips down to his car, and then the back end is down to the ground, and he drives away. And he saves these, not knowing what he's going to do, but he's just always loved his aunt. And so he saves them. And then finally, we meet him, and he's getting along in years, and he wants a new car. So he says, what do you offer me? And I says, what do you want? He says, well, I'd like to get a new car out of this. And this is, of course, when you could buy a Dodge Duster for $1,600 or something. So Sam Pennington and I go in halves, and we buy the collection from Ray, and this is how the book came about. But if it hadn't been for Ray, nothing would have been saved. But there were a few small collections elsewhere. In fact, Portland Museum of Art just came into a few pictures a couple years ago. But it's just saddens me to realize what is lost. Because if we had 1,200 pictures, 1,200 is really a summer's work for a photographer. It's not a lifetime. So all that stuff in the attic just went to the Farmington dump. And of course, that's what happened to a lot of glass plates, too, is that they would scrape the emulsion off the glass plate and build greenhouses. A lot of greenhouses. I mean, I don't know if you remember the greenhouse in Lewiston on Main Street. I can't remember the name. But that greenhouse was built out of glass plates. Well, anyway, so that's the story. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
If anybody would like one of Marius' books, he has some for sale. So.
Yeah, I have a few.
$20.
We'll stay for some refreshments.
And that concludes tonight's meeting of the Bethel Historical Society, June 1, 2000. Marius Peladeau discussing Chansonetta Stanley Emmons, professional photographer.